So Manolis, the stage is yours, and space communication as well.
Okay, good morning, everyone. This was an idea about doing a workshop for SDRs and how we can demodulate and decode data received from the SatNOX stations. So I think that we can go in two different ways. So depends on how is your familiarity with GNU Radio and SDR. So how many of you can use SDR and GNU Radio? Okay. So, who of you does not know anything about GNU Radio? That's good. We can go either. I have prepared a lot of stuff to do. We can go either for the basic stuff, so sampling theory and filtering and all this kind of stuff, or directly to the modulators part. So, do you prefer to cover it from the beginning or not? It's your choice. So, I believe that we should do a bit of intro in the GNU Radio stuff and in the OSDR stuff, and then pass to more DSP stuff a bit, and finalize with some kind of how we demodulate and decode data. Okay? Good. Okay, so what's a software-defined radio? The most basic question. What do you believe? We always say SDR, NSDR, SDR. What's about SDR? Come on, wake up. Alex.
I'm not an expert, but I
don't sit.
No. I just know this a common USB, like it's blue, and you plug in the computer, and in suppose you could see like a cascade, or you know, I just know that.
Yeah, but actually, SDR, the term SDR is a bit broad. Okay, so there are many SDR devices that are, like you said, a USB, and you control it from. From the host computer, or it can be other SDR device that does not have any host computer at all, and all the stuff runs on the FPGA. So ITU came up with this fancy definition of what SDR is, but to me at least it's something that you have the power to control it with software. So this software can run, of course, in any kind of device, like a host, a 686, x86 computer, or an ARM-based Raspberry, or even an FPGA that runs a MicroBlaze OS on it. Okay, so the idea is that you have a generic front end, and you configure it via software. Okay, I think that this is the definition of SDR, but everyone can have a different can come up with a different definition, of course. So why SDRs? Why we are talking about SDRs? What are the benefits of them? Ideas? Sorry? Extreme flexibility. Right. You are very right. Exactly. So the key characteristic of SDR is the extreme flexibility. So it is very easy to write code rather than doing analog stuff or even design an integrated circuit, right? And it costs less to write code in C or C++ or Python rather than doing weird stuff, weird analog stuff. Okay, so if you have an idea, you go design it in GNU/Radio or whatever. You test it. You transmit it also using an SDR device on the air, and then you come back to the drawing board and you do corrections or whatever. Okay, so they are extremely flexible and are also cheap, especially for new standards or new systems that you want to design. In terms of the space usage, of course you cannot go up there and repair a bug on the satellite. Years ago, this was a reality, but now it's not feasible. So why not sending the patch to the satellite and and eliminate the bug? Okay, so in such cases, it's very very important. Another very common usage of SDRs is now in base stations of companies selling mobile services, because there are rapid changes on the protocols. And imagine 3 years before you have the 3G plus, now we have the 4G, we are going to 5G, and they cannot sustain to, it's not sustainable to every time altering their hardware, hardware. So telecommunication companies have already integrated SDR devices into their base stations. It's something that is already on the industry. Disadvantages? Okay, I didn't include them, but do we have any disadvantages on the SDR usage? Disadvantages? Okay, so we have, I think that we have two major disadvantages there. The one is latency. We cannot compete, SDR cannot compete the latency of integrated circuits, of course. And the other one is, to my opinion, spectral purity. I don't know if you agree or disagree, but when you are building a generic RF frontend, something you gain, something you lose. And I think that the spectral purity of SDR device is not such, it's not so good regarding to a specific integrated circuit for a specific job. Yeah. Ah, yeah, of course, energy too. You can reduce it if you decrease the sampling rate, but yeah, energy is an issue too. Yeah, very good point. So the SDRs, as we said before, runs mainly on software. So depending on the needs of your application, this software can run either on a general purpose processor or an ASIC or FPGA. So it's your choice. You are the engineers, you are the designers, you know your application better, so you have to decide upon your requirements where this software will run. Okay, if you have very strict timing and jitter requirements, of course you are going directly to FPGA or ASIC. But if you can relax this and your application is only throughput limited, let's say, go directly for a general purpose CPU. So this is a typical SDR frontend. We have two or more TX paths, transmit paths and RX paths. We have some kind of filters, an analog to digital converter, and for the reception, digital to analog converter for the transmission. And most of the SDR devices right now have FPGA, either for doing stuff and controlling all this analog, all this integrated circuits, and transmit and receive data to the host PC or whatever. Right now, to be more specific, we have three different transceiver types. The most, the old one and the most common until now was the super heterodyne transceiver, which tries to convert the target frequency into an intermediate frequency, apply their filtering and the IQ demodulation, pass the resulting signal to the ADCs and DACs, and then to the FPGA. This was the most common until now. We have switched to zero IF SDR front ends, which do almost the same with the IF, with the difference that after the IQ demodulation and the mixing, the target frequency is at the baseband. So why this happening? So this is very common now in the most popular chips of SDR chips, like the LMS of Lime Microsystems and the AD9361 of Analog Devices. Why the trend is towards these transceivers is because if you go to the baseband, then the filters, these analog filters here, are very easy to design.
Easy.
Okay. So these have advantages regarding the super heterodyne. The new trend that have arisen on latest few years is direct sampling, which we have only some kind of filtering on the baseband and a very, very, very fast ADC or DAC. So we are talking about ADCs that are going that are sampling with terms of few gigahertz per samples. So until now, we do not have the technology, or we do not have the processing power to process such a great amount of data. But as we evolve and our chips become more and more sophisticated, now we are in we can manage such sample rates. Actually, in the SDR Maker Space program that I mentioned yesterday, we have an activity that plays and experiments with such a system at six gigasamples per second. Okay, so no need for intermediate frequencies, as you sample the entire band, the entire bandwidth from the baseband from 0 to 3 gigahertz in with sampling rate with the double sampling rate. Okay. Regarding software, we have three major SDR platforms that you can do stuff with them. It's the GNU Radio, the MATLAB Simlink, and the Pothos SDR. And we have there are three known libraries that can handle DSP stuff easily. It's the Liquid DSP, written in C. Volk is an SIMD-enabled library. SIMD is some kind of special instructions of the CPU that can handle multiple data simultaneously. And of course, the ITPP. Okay, Pothos can run on Windows too, MATLAB Simulink, of course. GNU Radio runs also in Windows, but you cannot develop there. It's very, very difficult to develop your own out of three modules. And all of these three libraries are, of course, open source. So what about the software? The software, as we said before, can run almost in any kind of language. Language is not a dependency, but if you have, again, it depends on your application. If your application has strict timing requirements, you should go to a compiled and compiled language like C++. And of course, there, SIMD instructions can increase significantly your throughput. FPGAs, yeah, I know they are hard to do to develop, and you need most of the times you need license for the software. But they can provide high throughput. They have very very predictable jitter and timing performance, and of course they can provide the lowest latency from other regarding other software implementations. So FPGAs is in the middle of software and hardware, but we consider them as software. Okay. Now, I think that most of you know about Neural Radio, right? So I can't know. Okay, I will say some basic stuff, and then we'll proceed on the next section. Okay. So yeah, what is GNU Radio? GNU Radio is an open source platform. It started at 2004, if I recall well. It is the core system of GNU Radio is written in C and C++, and it has some binding, some Python bindings through the Swig interface for easy connecting components. So you may see that the GNU Radio application is Python based, but underneath, it operates in C, C++. Okay, so so if you see on your process manager some kind of Python application, it is not running on Python. It's actually doing stuff in C, C++. And it has a graphical interface it's called GNU Radio Companion that provides a block design block programming language. Of GNU Radio, so you can connect components and construct your program. Of course, right now there are packets for every distro out there. So you do not have to compile it yourself. Go grab the packets from your packet manager. Okay. So this is a GNU Radio Companion. This is a canvas that we can design our flow graphs. So a GNU Radio program is called flow graph because it is graphical components that you connect the input and the outputs properly to construct the desired stream. So In the right section, you have the available blocks that are pre-installed with GNU Radio. Of course, you can write your own. So GNU Radio is very easily extensible. So if all of these blocks do not cover your application, of course, you can create your own. So I think that I can switch now to GNU Radio itself, so to give you an example, and then we'll continue with the stuff. So this is an example of flow graph. Let's create a new one. From the right side, you have all the available blocks. And let's say if I want to create a very simple frequency analyzer, I can insert, for example, just crashed. Okay. Let's create a signal source. So blocks that introduce data into the flow graph, they are called sources, and blocks that terminate data into a device or in a black hole, let's say, are called sinks. So every flow graph of GNU Radio should have at least one source and at least one sink. So I just inserted an analog signal source which is a cosine with a frequency of 1 kilohertz and a sampling rate of 32 kilohertz. And I want to display it, so I will bring inside my flow graph frequency sync, which is actually a spectrum analyzer. Okay. I connect the out and the input, and when I press the execute, yeah, okay, yeah, I should save the GRC. Now the GNU Radio will generate a Python script and will execute it, and this is the result. Okay, so this is the simplest one kind of example. So I don't know. Yeah, it's not actually visible, but here with this example, GNU Radio produced me a warning about not having a throttling mechanism on my flow graph. So why is this happening? Because this actually, every block that you insert in GNU Radio actually runs on a separate thread on your system. So GNU Radio does not throttle in any way your threads. So when you press the execute button, all of the threads in your flow graphs will try to operate on the maximum frequency of your CPU. So we can check that. If I press execute and then see my process manager, you will see that two of my CPUs here are saturated. And this is happening due to the blocks trying to produce samples in the maximum rate that they can. So this is not always the case. So when we have a device, let's say an SDR or an audio card, these devices operate on a very specific clock, dictated by the intended frequency. So, based on the sampling theory that we will cover in a minute, if your frequency is F, in order to reproduce properly the signal and not lose any kind of information, you should sampling with 2F, with the sampling rate 2 times F. Okay. So all of these devices, SDR, audio, or whatever, actually operate as a throttling mechanism for the software. So if the buffers of the device are full, you cannot push samples to it, and they will eventually block you and throttle you. Okay. So to avoid such things, when you are doing simulations in GNU Radio, you have to introduce a special block called throttle. Which actually do what it says. It tries to, by inserting sleeping intervals in every sample that passes, it tries to throttle you down into the intended sampling rate frequency. The sampling rate, So if I again press execute and now my simulation started and go now to the CPU utilization, we will see that my CPUs are almost idle. Okay, so when you are doing simulations, add a throttle block, or when you are dealing with hardware, you should not. So let me give you an example of that. Let's drive this signal to my audio card. Okay, so I will switch to baseband signals rather than IQ. So what about audio? What sampling rate should I have for audio? Do you know which frequencies our ear covers? Yeah? Okay, so we can hear about from about 100 hertz to up 22, the most good eyes. Yeah. I have done the same experiment in a course in the university, and I was able to hear up to 16 kilohertz, and there were people inside the classroom that was about 20. Oh, I'm getting older. Okay, so I will instruct my card to be at 48 kilohertz. And yeah, let me. And this is now the simulation propagating the samples through my audio card. You can hear these discontinuities, right? Why is this happening? Sorry? Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So because I'm running now on a proper device that throttles me down, I do not need this throttling block. Actually, the throttling block has a parameter of 48 kilohertz. It should work, right? But now we are coming back to a discussion on the disadvantages of software implementation. Software has a great amount of jitter. So if my jitter was okay, the throttle block at 48 kilohertz should not affect the sampling rate on the audio device, right? But due to the jitter and the buffering, it cannot handle properly the Nyquist frequency, the 2 times the sampling rate that is needed in order to transmit properly the signal. So let me bypass it. So radio supports bypassing. You can press bypass in order to disable, let's say, the throttle block, and press it again. Now it's perfect, right? Okay. So depending, as we said, it always depends on your application. This is a very simple example. Audio is one of the easiest to handle because the sample rate is very, very low. So as you're going to the RF, we are dealing with kinds of with sample rates of mega samples per second, even 100 in hundreds of mega samples per second. Okay. So it always depends on your application. Do properly your research, then specify the requirements, and then decide where your software will run, on a CPU, on a GPU, on a FPGA, or on whatever. Okay. So this was the first part of sort interaction to GNU Radio, and now we'll switch to DSP stuff. If you do not have any kind of question regarding GNU Radio, you're okay. So actually, I couldn't find a name for the folder of this presentation because if I started talking about SDR and DSP stuff, we can stay here for one day, I think. So I tried to summarize it and present you the most basic stuff in order to finalize with a complete flow graph of how we are dealing with a signal received by a SatNOG station. So let's start. So I have prepared the GNU Radio out of three module. Does not have any code, but only some examples that we'll see, we'll cover now. It is called GR Tutorial, it's on my GitLab page. And I have uploaded also two IQ files from my Saturnox station that we use them at the end to decode data, okay? But if someone wants to experiment, please send me an email and I will send whatever it needs. So we are starting with sampling and quantization. So what is the deal with them? So sampling, because a signal over the air is on the analog domain, right? It's on the analog world, but it is continuous. But an SDR device operates in a digital world. So sampling is the process of converting this continuous analog signal to discrete time instances and propagate the digital signal to the for further processing. Okay, so in sampling we have a very fundamental theorem, and it's called the Nyquist theorem, that says that if you have a real and mark the word real, because in the complex domain the things are a bit different. A real signal that has spectral content from zero to B hertz, B denotes the bandwidth. In order to reconstruct this signal and do not lose any kind of information, you should sampling it, digitally sampling it, with twice the speed, so with two times B, okay? And this sampling rate R, two times B, is called the Nyquist frequency. You can go higher, it's not a problem, but then what are the issues of going higher in the sampling rate? Anyone? Ideas? Aliasing, yeah. We can get rid of aliasing, but I think that most, for us as SDR developers, going higher means more CPU resources, right? Why spending CPU resources? So I need the minimum possible sampling rate that I should instruct my SDR device to operate. And this is the Nyquist frequency, okay? But we have problems. Most of the SDR devices, if I have, for example, a telecommunication protocol that operates on a sampling rate of 2 kilohertz, okay? And I go to my USRP or my Pluto SDR or my RTL SDR and I say to it, okay, operate on a sampling rate of 2 kilohertz. And it will respond me, fuck off, I cannot operate on this frequency. This is a very common problem, okay? We deal with them all the time. So we have two different operations to change sampling rate. It's called, the one is called decimation. It is, you divide the sampling rate integer decimate stages, you can reduce. So if I have a sampling rate of 1 megasample per second and I decimate by two, a factor of two, I end up with 500 kilosamples per second. Okay, and exactly the opposite is the interpolation, which increases sampling rate. So if I have a device, SDR device that operates only on 1 megasample per second, and I prepare in my host computer a signal that is on the 2 kilosamples per second, I then have to decimate it up in order to reach the target sampling rate of the device. You have aliasing, as C said before, but we can deal with them by filtering, by introducing filtering stages. Okay. Another interesting example is what we can do with both of them. So if we combine decimation and interpolation properly, we can target a very wide range of different subgrades. Okay. So this is called this process is called resampling. The resampler that uses only decimation interpolation is called rational resampler. You can find this rational resampler example in the radio. There is one. Okay. And another very interesting aspect of the SDR world and the digital signal processing world is the quantization. So as we said before, the analog signals are continuous in both time and amplitude. So with the sampling, we deal with the problem of the continuous analog signal in the time domain. In the amplitude domain, we should convert the signal in distinct places. And these distinct places depends also, of course, on your ADC, analog to digital converter, if you're doing RX, or on your DAC, digital to analog converter, when you're doing TX. Okay, and how many steps you have depends on the resolution of your ADC or DAC. Okay, and there is an issue there. So the less the resolution of your ADC or DAC, the more the quantization noise you have. And there's a rule of thumb that each bit that you introduce on the resolution of your ADC or DAC actually increase your SNR by a factor of 60 dBs. Okay? The problem here is how you choose this resolution of your ADC or DAC. Any ideas? One will say, okay, I know this is a problem. Why not placing there 32 bits and you will be okay for the eternity? I don't think that any kind of new modulation or any other kind of telecommunication stuff will need extra bits. It's cost. Have you ever wondered why the RTL costs about 20 euros and USRP some kind of 1,000? Exactly. Then if you increase, exactly, very good point. If you increase the resolution of your ADC or DAC, you need more resources, CPU resources or FPGA resources to handle these extra bits. And of course, it's again the aspect of energy, right? But how you decide how many bits you need? Exactly. So it depends again on your application. Have you any of you seen on your in your audio setup any kind of 24 bits DACs? It was like a feature on high-end audio devices some years ago. So audio has a very big dynamic range, because it needs a lot of power to drive the speaker to and vibrate. Okay, so audio has a very large dynamic range. On the other side, RF, because when you transmit RF signal, it attenuates with a logarithmic scale. Okay. So we deal with signals that are not so great in terms of dynamic range. So in audio, 34 bits is a must, is almost a must. In RF, we can play with systems that start from 8 bits, and high-end device may have up to 16. I haven't seen in any system with Alex, you, or anyone else. No, I think 16 is extreme case right now. I have an example of showing that. So here is a flow graph that tries to describe exactly what we are discussing right now. So this is a sine wave, and it is sampled with a quantizer of 8 bits. Let's decrease it. So for this amplitude, 8 bits are more than enough. You cannot distinguish between the red one, which is the analog, and the blue one, which is the digital. Okay, but as we are decreasing the resolution, as we are decreasing or increasing the resolution, you will see that these stages are more distinct now. And also you will see that the noise level starts to increase, right? So for every extra bit we add, we decrease our noise floor by a factor of 6 dBs. So if you come here and measure the signal to noise ratio, every bit I add, it decreases, the SNR increases by 6 bits, okay? But of course, it's kind of application. So I have here 6 bits, and my amplitude of the sine wave is from minus 1 to 1. But if I increase the amplitude, you will see that 6 bits now are not enough. And this phenomenon is called clipping. Okay, I have saturated my ADC. And it's very interesting to hear it. So the spectral content of this signal, the clipped signal, is an infinite number of harmonics, an infinite number of harmonics on the odd multiples of the base frequency. So it's interesting to drive the sound card to clip it and see and hear it yourself. So let me do it a bit. So with amplitude minus to 1, it was okay. And you could hear the 1 kilohertz frequency very well, but now it's always it is already distorted. If I decrease it to hear it properly. No. Wrong parameter, sorry. This is undistorted. Perfect, it does not clip. So it has only one frequency at 1 kilohertz. And when I distort it, let's say at if we do the spectral analysis of this signal, it will have an infinite number of harmonics. So as a rule of thumb, in order to have in your mind, for every bit we add on ADC or DAC, we gain 6 dBs. Okay, and now let's cover the filtering section. Why we use filters? What's the deal with them? Yeah. Two separate signals. Yeah, exactly. One use of them is separation. Another one? Exactly, noise reduction. Why? Why is this happening? Why when I use filters I reduce noise? Okay, yeah, yeah. Exactly, so noise is some kind of it has the trend to cover the entire spectrum that you observe, and this is called white Gaussian noise. Okay, so it contained spectral content that I do not need it. So it contributed badly to my and I have an example of it. It contributes badly to my system. So why keeping it? I use a filter to cut it off. Okay, okay, sure. And also, as is mentioned before, we have some kind of effects when we're doing resampling and stuff like that, called aliasing or imaging. So we use filters to get rid of these effects and to continue with our signal processing stuff. Okay. And another very interesting thing that most of the people do not have in mind is that with filters we can do pulse shaping. And we will see an example of pulse shaping in a while. Okay? So, what kind of filters do we use in an SDR application? As we saw before, every SDR frontend has some kind of filtering stages. And these filtering stages can be both analog and digital. So the analog filters are very good. We cannot live without them, but they have some serious drawbacks. They are difficult to design, and they cannot change their characteristics on the fly. Okay, so yeah, you can have different filtering stages, and with an RF switch, instruct your hardware to switch on another stage and stuff like that. But of course, you have limited resources in your PCB. Okay, you cannot do it forever. So we try to minimize the use of RF filters and place them only in places that are needed. Okay. On the other hand, we have the digital signals, the digital filters, sorry, which has all these advantages that we can think about. What are these advantages? Can you think about? Filters run on software, right? They consume resources, right? So, depending on your application, again, and on the requirements of your filters, filters can be very easy to calculate or very, 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 very hard. So, and this depends on some kind of their characteristics, and we'll cover it in a few minutes. So, let's cover the basic filter types. Okay, the most basic one is the low-pass filter. It's the filter that let the lower frequencies pass, as its name says, and cut off the higher. So this is the response of the filter, as we said. And here you will see that the input signal will not attenuate at all when it passes through the filter, and then when it starts to reaching the cutoff frequency, it started to attenuate. Okay? Reaching up to a cutoff level of minus 60 dB. Here is minus 50. Let's say that here is minus 60 dBs. This region when the filter starts to cut off, it's called transition width. So or F or stop band frequency, and the exact frequency, the exact transition width or the stop band frequency is called, we call it the frequency where the filter has also almost cut 3 dB of the input signal. So 3 dB it's may heard something like nothing, but have in mind that we are in the log scale. Okay, so 3 dB of attenuation of the filter means that your filter have attenuated your signal by half. So if you place 1 watt, 3 dB attenuation by the filter is on the output you have to observe. You will observe, sorry, half a watt. So half a watt became heat. Okay. It's not something insignificant. 3 dB is something big. Okay. Sorry? Okay. Yeah.
Thank you. On these graphs, why are the frequencies after the cutoff frequency only attenuated around to 60 and not all the way down?
Okay, of course, yeah. You cannot attenuate indefinitely, okay? You cannot, there is no way to cut it directly. You will need an infinite number of filter taps. We say it's filter taps, okay? So it is not possible. All these taps are generated through an iterative algorithm that tries to alter the number of the taps and the coefficients in order to reach your intended cutoff frequency and the intended transition width. Okay, so it's you cannot cut it if you want to cut it as a rectangular window, let's say, it will require an infinite amount of frequency coefficients, filter coefficients. Okay, it's it's from the theory. You cannot do that. Okay. So the high pass filter is almost the opposite of the low pass. And if you combine both of them, you can have the band pass filter or the band reject. Okay. And just to sum up with the filters. For example, here we have a very steep filter that. The transition width is very, very, very small, and we have here a more relaxed one, with the transition width is like a curve. So to have in mind, this filter requires has about 6,000 taps, and this one only 65. Okay, so huge difference. They are both low-pass filters, but there is a huge difference on the processing requirements between the two of them. So, again, you are the designers, you are the engineers, you know your application. So, depending on your needs, you have to decide either which guidelines you will follow here in order to be your application real-time or meet the requirements that you have specified. So let me switch to the two Satnox observations to see the effects of filtering and how they can help us to decode the data. Okay, and then you are free to go for your lunch. So here is a flow graph of an observation. From the Satnox network, we store the signal in a signed sorted Z format to reduce the size of the file. So this block converts from sorts to complex representation, and then I'm doing a scaling up in order to have the whole dynamic range that I will need. And just afterwards, just a normalization in order to my signal to be on plus one, minus one scale. Okay. And I have some kind of filtering stages. I will disable right now them to be more clear for you, and then we re-enable them. Okay. Sorry. Yeah. So the red one is the unfiltered with noise. So you may see here the spectral content that I need. It's an FSK on 9K of 9K bandwidth, but there are. There is spectral content in a frequency that I do not care, right? So, as our colleague said before, we do not need them. Why not cutting them out? Okay. So after applying the low pass filter, I got this one. Okay. I could do that more steeply, but then because in Saturn we have. Effects like frequency drifting, right? So the clocks of the satellites or the SDR at the ground station drifts a lot. So this could move, and if you observe it, it's moving a bit right on the right and on the left. Okay, so it's a trade-off between performance and if you do not want to lose the transmission. Okay. So let's proceed with this one and see how it appears on the time domain. So FSK modulation is very easy. You use the quadrature the mod operation, which is actually just multiplying with a conjugate of the one by one delayed sample. It's quite easy, and that's why most of people on amateur or academic satellites use FSK. It has also some kind of other advantages, like it is very resilient in frequency offsets. But to the most common reason about using FSK is that it is very easy to decode and modulate. So let me enable the quadrature mode. Okay. The red one is the unfiltered version. Okay.
Yeah.
we can see that something there is something there because when I can see some kind of pattern, right? But of course, I can I'm not able to clearly see the bitstream, right? But if I apply filtering, look how easier it is to demodulate. So you see, I almost can see the one and zeros right there, right? So one bit is on the high level and 0 bits on the low level, okay? And there is also another problem. The sampling rate of the signal that we are dealing with was 48 kilohertz. Now these dots are on the 48 kilohertz, but my application was on the 9,600 kilobits per second. So what I can do? I have five times the information that I need. Exactly. How? How?
Decimate.
Sorry? Decimate. Yeah, I can decimate. Let's try the decimated one. So there is a block in radio called keep one in M. So by keeping one sample in 5, I decimate by a factor of 5. So my target sample rate then will be 9,600 bits per second. But there is a very big problem there. My clock with respect to the satellite clock are not ticking at the same time, right? So when my clock ticks, I'm not sure that the clock of the satellite ticks at exactly the same time, and it's impossible to clock at the same time. So this is called this is an effect that is called symbol timing error. And if I sample in the in the exact same time with a satellite, I have a degradation of my RF performance. So there are tricks, and are called symbol synchronization or clock recovery, that tries to eliminate this offset. How they do that? You gave to these algorithms more information, more samples per second, and they try to adjust by properly introducing delays on the samples in order to sample almost at the same time that the satellite transmit the corresponding sample. And this is called symbol sync. There are many ways to do that. It's either symbol sync or clock recovery. There is very popular clock recovery mechanism that also GNU Radio has it. And it's called Mueller and Muller clock recovery mechanism. So if you are interested in such stuff, we can discuss about them on the lunch. Okay, so let me plot the simply decimated version and the version of the signal passed through clock recovery. It's this one. Yeah. So the blue one comparing to the red one, if we manage to take a look at the red one, it's sampled always on the most smallest and on the highest part of the signal. So the clock recovery mechanism tried to maximize my performance by sampling them on the sweet spot. Okay, regarding to the simply decimated sample, which is the blue, where you can observe that it is not on the sweet spots. So if you consider that the zero axis is the decision boundary for 1 and 0 bit received, probably the blue one will produce errors comparing to the red one, which probably not. Okay, so they have larger distance from the decision boundary. And that's how we decode satellite signals. Thank you.